It's been running all day.
Well, it says
all day, running.
Ladies and gentlemen, hobos and ants, cross-eyed mosquitoes, and bow-legged ants. Since I don't know the rest of that, I'm going to stop. Welcome to Sacred Grounds, everybody. Give yourself a small round of applause, or a square of applause, for a tetrahedral dodecahedron shape. Anyway, I'm Dan Brady, I'm your host. I'm saying this primarily in case anybody is out there, but I know you know me. And if you're not familiar with this place, and if you see someone who's not, you don't really know, well then you're gonna be in for a surprise, because that's the way it is. And if you see somebody you do know, you don't know what they're gonna be reading. So, surprises happening here. Longest running poetry open mic since 1972. I found a quote somewhere that said it was 1971. Or 72, so I'm going with 72 still, because that's what I heard. We have a Facebook page, and there's a link there, and also happens in the emails that I send out. The keynote
this evening
is Richard Sandorell. Our feature is in-house Clara Sue, or where did she go? She's around here someplace, maybe in that direction. A well-known poet, bon vivant, and the mini feature is David Erdweich, who's not here yet.
But anyway,
Mr. Natural, we thank him for the streaming, and we got some fabulous prizes here, just really quickly. Yoga of the Impossible, in case. True Romantic Poems by Zhu Jimo. I'm not sure I'm saying that right, but that's from Clara Sue. She gave me. Put it here. We have the author of Word Pictures in the house. If you take this prize, it'll be her honor decided for you. And The Days I Moved Through Ordinary Sound. I'm doing that right now.
There are a few other things which I'll talk about, the features. This is a collection of stuff from the Southern Poverty Law Center. It's like reports and papers and things. Since when I got involved with them, they still send me stuff every once in a while. So it's a nice packet introducing you to that.
And then, of course, on the 13th of January, we're going to be dealing with this issue as well as Miss Saunders over there. She's going to be featuring.
That was last Monday.
But there's one on the 13th here, because they're doing a world one on the 14th of January. So anyway, that'll be here. The theme of the night is varieties of love as expressed in poetry. We have that theme. Didn't have a chance to send it out because I didn't get it too late. The light condom is on, the amp is going.
Let's see what else is here. This is still running. If you have a cell phone, you do what I do, turn it off, because that sometimes helps this. If you read a poem by someone else, I hand you a card like this, so you can write the name of the poet, your name, the name of the poet, and the poem, so I can, you know, keep track of that. That'd be nice. And of course, this is the email list. If you want to get that, I send out something once a week. Also, I post on the Facebook page. We're set with that. Is there anything else?
No. This is where I would usually tell a joke, but I don't have a joke except for George W. Bush. That's getting old.
Anyway, I'm going to sit down now. Cease my peripatetic wanderings. I've made my duly appointed announcements. We are beginning.
You have to watch.
May I have your attention? May you direct your attention to the mic where Mr. Sandorell will be addressing you in just a moment. Addressing, not undressing. Oh, sorry. And give him a small round as he comes up here to kick this out.
This is going to be short and sweet. By Joy Harsh. Trickster. Crow, in a new snow, you caw-caw like crazy. Laugh, because you know I am a fool, too, like you. Skimming over the thin ice, so the war going on all over the world. Trickster.
I told you it was going to be short.
You guys never believe me.
I always believe you, except when you don't.
This?
Yeah, it's there.
Oh,
I'll take the glasses.
Oh, I thought you wanted to be able to read later.
Is that all you're going to do? I told you it was going to be short.
Oh, I thought you meant it was a single short piece of several short pieces. I'm sorry.
Well, you know, I could go on, but I am so out of breath because it's been like that all day. So I don't want to do her damage by not reading her properly.
All right. Well, then let me introduce.
Always respect the poet.
Respect that poet. Give him a round. Respect the poet. Since we're not going to get you off. That's right. All right. The next five. I'm just going to read the names really quickly so you know where you are. We have Jane Redis, then Buford, then Sally, then Jack, then Owen. Oh, maybe that's not Owen. Number five before Owen, I can't read that.
Alice.
Oh, Alice Rogan. That's the L. Okay. So we got Jane, Buford, Sally, Jack, Alice, Owen, Bill, and Bob Marley from here. All right, so Jane Avedis, please give her a nice warm welcome.
Thank you, Dan. Great to be back here. Thank you. Two newer poems. The Open Road. The road has always been open. That turn in the road not taken. Maybe it was the one. Many directions I could have gone. North, south, east, west. Even up and down. Aiming for conclusion, ending at the center of things. On target. Red wing circling, a bird overhead soaring, moon setting over the bridge, soft glow of dusk, lighting the road, opening ahead. Thanks, Karen. Nice. This is Let a Memory Stay a Memory. You can't go home again or recapture the past. It's a fleeting gazelle in an African wild. Like going back to visit Holy Hill, a small Catholic shrine in the Wisconsin countryside. In the 60s, an old church surrounded by thick green woods, an altar piled high with crutches and canes left there by the cured, intimate, comforting. By the year 2000, it had evolved. Two levels of parking lots, unsmiling men directing traffic, crowds in a new store of religious artifacts and a cafe. Let a memory be a memory. Can't go back. That was you, whether you like it or not. You ask, can I do it over? It wasn't that much fun. You might get another chance if you believe in the hereafter. Time travel, only for the fittest. And there's a lot of space out there. Rest with the memories. Thank you.
Thank you. We've got Buford coming up next. All right. We give him a nice little bit of a warmth as he comes up to the microphone.
This is some old poetry I ran up on from 10 years ago. This is called Alligator. Like an alligator, I have not quite survived the Gulf Coast swamp, my scaly skin damp, peeling. The feel of the West Coast sun beating down in March outside and nearing me to a better life after being shut down from love. I look back at the humid and the arid air of California beaches and oceans on each shore. The dilapidated house, my furious brother's warm breath blasted toward me. The dogwood trees are dubious shade in the near 100 degree heat and humidity. My walking away to his sad frown, my needing yet another drier new day. More is called reading. She reads the poem out loud in the convalescent home where our group performs its original literature for the day, our once monthly Saturday of glory. It's a sensual poem I've heard about making love. She's older. She knows about it. Knows about me. talking to me in her car afterward, and her primness. Nice gray, cut clean, not too long hair, not too wild hard, it seems. But the poem shows passion. I tried to imagine her pulling off her thick red cardigan sweater in the restaurant. She mimics it when I ask her to give it to me. She's worried about my thin cotton shirt in the cold, wet winter night. While we're sitting across the table in the Indian restaurant from each other, she wants more tea.
Thank you. Super. Thank you. All right, Sally Love Saunders is next. Give her a nice round as she comes up. We have Jack, Alice, Owen, Bill, Karen, Louie.
Getting ready to go with this poem. I don't know where it came from. I think I wrote it. It's sitting right on top of my pocketbook. Alone with the quiet, the dust settles, and the truth from within speaks. A rooster's voice is heard from far away in the hills. Let me read it again. Alone with the quiet, the dust settles, and the truth from within speaks. A rooster's voice is heard from far away in the hills. We're two identical stars, apart, pinned to separate spots, but giving forth the same light and glow. Twin stars close together, off in our own space in the galaxy, away from the busy Milky Way and changing neon signs. Together yet apart, same glow uniting us, connected also by our own special light. I wrote this at one of my poetry workshops. It goes, exciting to be present for the birth of a poem. The expectancy, feeling the creative contractions as a baby poem comes into the world, after birth and all. I cheer and hug the mother poet. Exciting to be present for the birth of a poem. Memories, golden fishes swimming gracefully in the bowl of clear water, which is my soul. So alive they swim, displaying their beauty. Thank you.
So, Lola Saunders, whose book is in the collection of possible door prizes there, and I'll sign it for you. Well known in the Bay Area. All right, Jack Melander. Jack Melander, then Owen, then Alice Owen Bill.
Thank you. Give a nice round as it comes up here.
Secret. Secret. None ask why man that Eldritch elf e'er strives to be, upon what whim, the motherfucker to himself that his fate is to him. An up poem. The rain flashing, the gale rumbled, he skated out in the cold and dark, then sweeping downhill, lightly stumbled against wind so relentless stark that gravity itself was humbled. Is it some cafe that light reveals? To a bus stop bench he glided, doffed his ride for red spring heels, so the lightness stayed decided. With his pack of pinioned wheels nearly into the black and hoisting, he went with bounding stride through the brazen doors and hoisting off on the waitress, smiling inside, with lips her tongue had been wasted. He'd a levitation sensation so free, thus multiplied by three, the wind is springs, her smile is he that underneath the hanging TV he covered, above her bosom barely covered. She looked at him from her bottles and kegs and laughed as he folded his legs. Epicurean decree. If 1/365th of every year we celebrate, not always with some smoke or fifth, one New Year's Day, then at that rate we remain in the new millennium's depth for 99 days of revelry yet. Let me vote for parties of genuine fun. Lovemaking is a type of ecstasy, like fervid sex with a willing hind in rest and healthy energy. All pleasures else than this sort of joy must be some falling off, distortion, alloy. But it's not in the spirit of festivity to prescribe, or prioritize what females, fluids, or plumes may be most apropos pleasures to exploited guys, thrust in the unlikely situations of having to party with great jubilation.
Now, we have the honor of presenting Alice Roldoff, editor of the Great Aspen Liberty News, Village Journal, and Faithful.
And
not everyone is Dan's height.
Listen, I tried my best, but my mom studied Penn State.
I was strong to the finish.
I ate my spinach. So, no.
I've moved and traveled and moved again and had companions and sporadic lovers, a husband, but each bus ride, train station, new apartment I've had, the guitar is always with me. Sometimes a different one, bigger, smaller, a traveling string. 12-string guitar, one for my fancy, one to play jazz on the high note. Finally, a new teacher under the Chicago L tracks in my old neighborhood at the music store. I kept playing even when friends died, when they drifted or homes were sold, old friends went away, a job began or left. I stuck with the guitar, played not always well, sometimes really good, sometimes really bad. In Mexico, I played with people who sang in Spanish. When I would turn around, my guitar was always there.
Alice Roldoff, ladies and gentlemen, a rare treat. Owen, come on up here, and then we got Bill, Karen, Louie. Looks like. I'm not sure if it's Candace.
Is Columbo going to be here tonight?
He promised, but he's busy decomposing.
Nobody ever believed me.
I believe you, except when I go. But I'm paranoid schizophrenic. This is Owen, Dr. Lady Dillon. Give him a little bit of applause. Thank you, Owen.
Christmas poem. Rosen cavaliers all riding, decorations all bright. The dull, busy day, lights blinking off and on. The cold, sharp holiday of Christmas. Fresh feels and forgets, feels and forgets. Chant Noel. Memory ensconces itself. Bad poems. My brain can think of some bad poems. Trucks, taxi cabs, buses, people, all busy on Third Street. Words there order themselves to greet the dawn. Five lines. The sun has conquered the day. Cherries blossom on the equator. The day is clouded with desperation, confusion and doubt on the city streets. I am devout on the city. Sonnet, Mother's Birthday. The wind flow me along my torturous way towards the phenomenon of awards, the dynamo called Market Street, among beggars beseeching shoppers and none. A subdued Halloween, cards for mother, of course, not tardy to her, thrifty Scorpio, the throng. I almost jogged by in a hurry, stopping by the post office, half filled with quietude. I scurried back to the library, half thrilled. Another hard, sharp Wednesday eve. Not face to face, I only believe. Palms. Only the chatting midnight rain beats down from its sultry showers. Erase a unicorn upon its sultry towers. Chimes from its nocturne time and again. Wetting its lips upon my eaves of pain. Its cold branches tell of the hours. Laughter and lust become ill. Sours the bleak covenant we call the sea. Gods and princes all begat. A nimmy voice, goat-bearded boy. Odysseus set sail. We never sat along your passing in penance. Destroy the harp of plenty we plucked in the day standing. Bid the sun end you.
Yes, Owen.
Spring. Spring trajectory cake sails. Sour forth clouds clap the sky. The miracle maid swimming, born to be alive, cancer six. Please peace, you seem so fine and full. The ways foretell the future. Beg now, pay later. Elock the glace to God, and the seashell sings the remotely wise. River donor cactus can say my last syllables, beg the air for more. The directory the wind tells you, I can feel them. So the end is near two more times. Death of the maiden lasts till dawn.
Thank you all.
All right, Owen's uncle.
All right.
Owen's uncle.
Let's see who is. Oh, Mr. Bill.
Mr. Bill
is coming on up here. Then we got Karen, Louie, Candace, Richard. Mr. Bill. Mr. Bill. And I'm in there somewhere, I forgot. I won't be long.
You better be in there somewhere there, bro.
I'm in here.
We love you.
Thank you for that. I appreciate the opportunity to swerve. Speaking of swerving, he's taking the mic now. I shall cease my
and I'm armed, so. So me.
Hey.
Flagrant promotion here. The Promenade Cafe is going to kick off the new year on the 2nd. So everybody come and let poetry begin your year. And featured are Stephanie Manning.
Stephanie Manning.
And myself.
All right.
This is the last reading here this year.
Yes.
And we're about to run out of year. I like to whip out my favorite poem of completion at about this time of the year whenever I can, and listen with a special thought for John Trudell here. This is from The Tempest. Our revels now are ended. These, our actors, as I foretold you, were all spirits and are melted into air, into thin air. And like the baseless fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples, the great globe itself, yea, all which it inherit, shall dissolve. And like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a cloud behind. We are such stuff as dreams are made on, and our little life is rounded with a sleep.
Oh. Thank you. Thank you.
That's Bill to you. Bill. Thank you, Bill. Mercy A. All right.
Will you be signing dollar bills for us later on?
Margaret Mead. Donna Reed.
Marlon Brando. Lake Mead.
Marlon. He promises and promises and promises. And what do I get? I could have been a contender.
A pint of mead.
Thank you. But Karen Huff is coming up. She knew this. She always knew this. I was delayed in the game,
restaurant,
so she feel rushed and all that. So give her a nice round as she comes up here. Just kick her out of the old window and surprise those people that always get football supply into theirs.
No,
thank
no.
you so much.
I seem to be in the big room.
There we go.
Lost coffee cup, discovered at last in microwave. Wet with tears of 3 days isolation and stale grounds.
You've been over to my place, huh?
Yeah. You ever live in a really small place and you can't find something for days?
Yes.
Yeah.
And there's only so many places to get.
Every single day I have this.
I know. Tear the place apart.
The facts of life. Christopher informs me with the certainty of 6-year-olds that there are more boys than girls in the room because Santa's reindeer fly in our window. Christopher, I tell him, Santa's reindeer are girls, every single one. No, he says. Absolutely, I respond. Look at them. Male reindeer drop antlers every autumn. Females keep them through the winter. But Miss Hoffy protests, that isn't fair.
Oh, Rudolph's.
Is that true?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that is true.
Wow. My fantasy, childhood fantasies are.
You know, you learn something new every darn day. But as far as Rudolph goes, that's the most recent, you know, addition to the reindeer group. I thought it was.
Yeah.
First.
Well,
so.
He doesn't have antlers. Well,
there you go.
Painting pelican dreams. Subarctic zephyrs tickle my skin beneath ruffled feathers, create whispering harmonics, music enough for this albatross journey, surfing thermals for 3,000 miles over open ocean, on the wings of a pelican who barely dared to dream of adventuring so far from land. Where do we go when we paint? When the last brush is cleaned and set to dry, must that secret gate forever vanish as though it had not led us into worlds beyond ken of words? When salt breeze lifts the hairs on my forearm, I remember, like a childhood tale, flying, flying there inside a pelican's dream. Feather of hope. Ugly escalations of xenophobia, nightmares peddled 10 for a dollar by frightened narcissists and self-righteous ignorant men who still may stand to profit from unprovoked attacks inspired by those speeches. Deaths of innocents inciting further radicalization among their counterparts. The enemy, whose face is in the mirror, are their own faces. And yet, in Chicago today, high school girls of all creeds arrived in headscarves to show solidarity with their Muslim sisters, to dare the vitriol of men who think you can somehow throw stones to extinguish an endless pool of light.
Wow.
You know, that brings up something I sometimes say at the beginning. Don't hold back. What's the use? What's the use of not saying what you need to say, what you want to say, what needs to be said? If you can't say it here, then why are you here? You know? So let loose and think.
It's only going all over the world on the internet. Well, don't worry. You know, no one's going to be looking for you.
Well, that's my problem. We got Louie coming on up here, then Candace, then Richard, then me, then Martin, then our feature, Clara Suso.
Louis, entre vous.
All right. Part two, ladies and gentlemen.
This is the second half of Mr. San Francisco.
Can't hear you.
I wonder if
Hold on, the plug came out.
Yeah, the plug is out.
The plug is out. We're going to have to stand to the side, please. Okay. I don't want to move the
it's unplugged.
Are we back? Yeah, we're back.
Hold on a second. I'm going to obviate this event from before.
You get lucky, Dan.
Note that word, obviate.
Obviate.
Yes, we could obviate a lot of things here. We'd be better off.
That's why we're
This is one Brady unit, one literary unit, 5 minutes. That equals 5 minutes to a lot of people these days. And this is the second Brady of this piece called Mr. San Francisco, an Update. If you're confused, you didn't hear the first part, so here we go. But perhaps I'm being too hard on these kids. Maybe work no longer matters. Maybe it is just one of those silly generational things. Founding Father Thomas Jefferson seemed to think, however, that the more he worked, the luckier he was. Cain claimed that he lived a charmed life. Was hard work a factor? But what are these old dead punks now? The times, they have changed, haven't they? Mr. San Francisco lived in a period when homelessness was not sprawled out everywhere, when mental health issues were not constantly in your face, when some of the infrastructure of the city got fixed, when every new building was not another stucco box, when the word classy meant something other than old-timer ramp, when there were boulevards and it was safe to walk them. And perspective. That has changed too, hasn't it? Then there was reality and Kane's good old vitamin D that made it a little more palatable. Now there are pills and virtual reality. And though the mechanism of the human eye has not changed since Descartes explained it, people see things differently. Back then, when Mr. Kane walked the boulevards of the city, whether it was Kane or some other character, there was a common perspective that prevailed. Back then, people read from the same page, an expression now used by people who were trying to get you on it, or at least have an honest discussion about reality, and they agreed or they disagreed. There were common issues, shared and known, and they weren't just my issues, which I programmed to receive news about on a handheld device, excluding all other issues. And of the news that I followed, it was not just from some wacky source, most likely a blog that shared my own quirky view. It was from a news source that was edited, to which were applied a modicum of journalistic standards. Forget all that today. News now comes raw and unedited in the form and with the content that I want to see. So what if it reads more like fiction? It's what I want to read. It's what I want to hear. It's the news my way. Gross, in her New York Times article called San Francisco Club, and this was probably true back then, in the days of Kane, there was a semblance of social order. Society, if you want to call it that, and Kane always made fun of it, especially when it came to events like the opera. But it was fun to read about. This societal order, like the news, provided some perspective on the kinds of people who lived in the city. Now that is gone, of course, and it is a kind of free-for-all with no sense of who's who. Now it is the dude, the big ego, the loud voice that prevails. If you can shout louder than the guy or gal with something to say, you are the man, the woman, though certainly not Mr. or Mrs. San Francisco. And if you got more devices that amplify your particular brand of nonsense, you win. Others can't hear themselves think. Awesome is a matter of volume. Oh my God, rules the day. But maybe you don't want to know too much about the new social order and the new San Francisco. He or she is an irritated and angry person who pushes through lines, and if you were walking a straight path down the sidewalk and he or she is coming out of a shop or restaurant, he or she will walk right into you in what seems to be a game of chicken. If there is a collision, do not expect an apology. Expect instead the F word. And if he or she is not in motion, which is rare, he or she will have his or her device out, earplug, blood, buds, plugged in to blot out the world, and he or she will be staring at the piece of plastic in his or her hands. One last detail, if it is a guy, he will surely have one hand in a pants pocket and be holding the piece of plastic at a 30-degree angle to the sidewalk as though for a photo op. Like the image of the new San Franciscan? Does the new San Franciscan sound like Mr. San Francisco? What about language? Does it still matter? Should it, like society and manners, take a hike? Mr. Kane was particularly fond of language, the right word, the clever phrase, and a language that turns in upon itself in the oxymoron. He would probably be appalled with the language heard on the streets and in the cafes today. Hey, dude! What the fuck? Oh my god! Cool. Awesome. Kind of boring, huh, dude? And with the same word, fucking, used to describe almost everything under the sun, Mr. San Francisco would likely see this as a further evidence of a city in decay. How descriptive, how adjectival is a single word used to describe all other words? What does it tell us about the noun? It tells us more about the person using that word than the thing that that person is attempting to describe. But again, maybe I need to harshen my evaluation of today's San Francisco. With a lack of jobs, decent and affordable housing, crime, and environmental worries, how could he or she be other than a little demented? That's not the end. There's another section to follow.
Yeah.
That's one Brady unit. One literary unit in San Francisco for Brady. And that was 5 minutes.
Thank you.
You know, a friend of mine, hold on a second. Candace, now before she comes up here, she's not aware of the fact that she's a new person here and that we have a special
She's not aware she's new?
Kindly come up and let us regale you with our applause, please. Give her a round of applause. Just be really close.
Okay.
There you go.
What is this one called? I just might get the title right now. The Craft. We're not going to hurt anyone, okay? There needs to be trust here. I'm sensing a lack of trust. We need to come up with a song, and it'll change our lives in just one night. Tell me you love me, only for tonight. I repeat, hoping to change the world. I see the hooded face. I say he is who he isn't. Again, I want to change the facts.
Yeah.
Grandiose. Capturing your image was so innocent, but the exchange was unfair. Now I am ashamed. I'm the one to blame, and you don't even feel the same. Jeopardize my life and virtue just to be close to you. Oh, what do I do just to be close to you? My fragile little mind can't find time to unveil this crime. Instead, I dream of you from another point of view, where you love me in return. There's no lesson to learn. Sorry if you were at the promenade, I read this one. Only if we meet again. I will not express my true feelings, the ones I've confessed to strangers through my writing. I will act casual like I've done in the past. I will hold back the madness I've gone through, the delusions and dreams. I will carry this burden, these thoughts, so I do not upset you, although you've upset me 7 or 8 times. Only if we meet again, just in case, perhaps we could meet again. What a sad thing to say, but I'm being honest. Last time, I had intentions of confessing my anger, but the time I've gone without a hello or a crude photograph has made me obsessed. You're the muse of bad poetry. Your spell made me sick and unmotivated, with nothing else to consume my thoughts. But this is only if we meet again. Until then, I'll wonder and find someone like you. but no one can compare to your beauty. Because honestly, that's what I want, to be acknowledged by a rare face, to be soothed by a concerned voice. Everything you said was a lie, but I love them, those words. I see now that I'm after the idea of you, but I'll never express these thoughts. Don't want to complicate things. Only if we meet again. Blinking and bright lights, a plant in a chemical imbalance, a dark symbol. I went through hell to find you. I went to the balcony in the back, where the sun met the ocean, and the clouds were gray and purple. The angel sitting on the balcony knew the secret I was trying to find out. If I had the power to move the clouds, I'd paint your face, but I never practiced with a pen. I looked deeper and tried to find my true love. It's the height of the sky, and it's the depth of the sea, because who I really love is me.
Nice. Stand there.
Don't hold back. Thank you so much. Mr. Richard, yeah, man. I could go up and you could go back to me. Oh, I'm just checking because I'm after you and I could switch to convenient eyes.
I must be a blind man. I didn't sign in for 11.
Yeah, see, you're real 11.
My God, all those people were red. Where was I? All those people were
red.
Was I here for all those people?
The same.
Probably not. We had 11 people red.
Probably, kind of like you. Mind goes before the mind.
And I'm going to test to that, everyone. The brain is going. Let me sign off on this. All right. Where did that clear? Oh, okay. We got a new one. Coyote goes to Oklahoma.
Yeah.
You lost.
Coyote feels restless. City life begins to bore. He was going to take his family to Oklahoma. It's been a while. However, there's a lot in the news about oil, fracking, and earthquakes, so Coyote decides to travel alone, unsure of the unstable ground of what will happen. He hoped to meet up with his cousin Coyote, but is unable to make contact. Cousin Coyote has a device, so Coyote goes to his friend Crawling Kingsnake to use his laptop, just like good Amish do. Still, he's unable to get a reply. Coyote also wants to meet with his two-legged friends, whose ancestors, along with those that followed, were forced onto reservations. Coyote wants to let the two-legged know that about the struggles and solutions their brothers and sisters in the West, the Ohlone, Pomo, Miwok, Wuunwinwintu, naming a few, are toiling under. These are the territories where Coyote roams, where the struggle remains much the same as when he arrived. Now, even California fracks. Coyote takes the train, then the bus down to get to where he's going. Coyote travels low-key. He considered asking Kingsnake to travel with him, but realized November might be too cold. It'll send Kingsnake into hibernation. Coyote arrives outside the Miami Res, where he finds protesters and the speaker saying, "Your greed has caused the earth to collapse into itself. Water filled with poisons that breathes fire. You come and tell us the fracking is safe, but when it's done, we live with the consequences, the results of your lies. Our mother quakes where she hasn't in millenniums. The state has many pipelines throughout, protesters diverse as farmers, city dwellers, and native nations, all upset about the small quakes that occur with regularly frequency that are now increasing to 4.5. Quakes are occurring in many states, and no one pays the consequences. Coyote doesn't recognize the speaker, but after looking, spies his cousin Coyote. Both gestured in a silent howl, greeting. Coyote says to cousin that he knew that he would see his cousin at some event like this. After Coyote informs his cousin's news of the North Coast, cousin tells of Oklahoma's. Cousin and Coyote agree that the flora and fauna need to join the two in the same way to grapple with this common struggle against those who would destroy itself for profit, whether religious, corporate, government, or other. You know, the Empire way. Before heading out, Coyote made contact with the two-legged friends from the region and planned for a future meeting while there. Coyote and Cousin decided to go to Cousin's den, where another small quake rolls by. That's when Coyote came upon his idea. Let's place cameras throughout the state. there will be a, there is a quake every once a day. Show the world a time collage of the whole state shaking and quaking with the earth collapsing into itself. Show the, how the flora and fauna and the two-legged react to becoming the earthquake capital of the world. What great advertising for fracking. Back at the den, Coyote and Cousin breaks out their instruments and play some earthquake blues as tumblers roll past her planning the next move in Solidarity's coalition. USA kill John Wayne. Some Native people saying John Wayne has wooden teeth. He certainly had a wooden spine. Ah, USA's macho man, give me the Marlboro Pilgrim, and was fed his addictions. Besides, doctors recommended on taste, coolness, mentholated. We are USA, and we feed addictions, candy-coated with new flavors. Cherry Pop-Tart ice cream, for example, with artificial colors and flavors. Marion Robert Morrison, frontier and war hero in the movies, smoked six packs a day that gave him lung cancer. Stomach cancer killed him from the downwinder film, The Conquerors, in 1956, where besides Wayne and his high, as many as high as 60% of the cast and crew died of cancer from the fallout that fell on the film site from nuclear testing in North Nevada's southeast. John Wayne was the famous Indian killer who always showed the gringo as hero. The same for his war movies. Marion was always the hero. Made the famous movie The Green Berets. He supported the Vietnam War, where young men who watched the Green Berets joined the military and were usually the first killed because they acted like John Wayne. Oh. Yeah. John Wayne would never know what it was to be a in the military. He stayed home during World War II and made movies while others did the dying.
That's right.
I am fortunate to have a friend and veteran brother who received the Purple Heart. He has many First Nations bloods runs through his courses through his veins. A man of wit, he placed the true grit John Wayne doll on a cross nailed by arrows in all the appropriate areas. Behind him, the obscenity of the damage done by this pilgrim. When he displayed it as art, shows the gringos, they become red-faced, anger, joy. For Michael Horst, the great humorists.
Nothing up my sleeve.
I just want to do one thing before I do my hike. I'm going to do hike because that's going to be short.
When I was teaching second grade, one of my favorites would say I was a magician, and they wouldn't believe me. And I'd say, watch. And I'd say, watch the magic hands. And they'd go like this. And I'd go, three at once. And I'd go, toss them up to the air. Whoa. Yeah. What? Huh. Oh.
Wow. Go, whoa. I do that slower. I want to see that again. Oh, you know.
And then there's always this one. Tink, tink. Whoa! Anyway.
Don't read the news. Thank you so much. So today I went out for a walk, and it's a haiku walk, so-called, because I look for haiku, find them, and I write them down, and I try to rewrite them. And so this is off the top of the head, so to speak. Some dewy plums on an offering plate. Overgrown Shiva lingam. Some dewy plums on an offering plate. Overgrown Shiva lingam.
Overgrown what?
Shiva lingam. It's a statue that goes to the, well, Funkin' Wagnalls. Lone peak far away, clouds cover and uncovering memories of you. In my country now, aging veterans read the plaque where for a time dew gleams. Okay. The graves in winter, rain clouds far off, hint of lightning, thunder with prayers. His hospice sick room, by the frosty window, an empty space. A few stray drops mark the ground, connecting the dots, hospice, walkabout. These two are fun. Deserted parking lot, the rusty old Ford pickup clatters with the hail. Couldn't believe it. So noisy. Over frosty fields, the howling chorus. Even out here, the game. Young moon, soft gray, the butterfly's antics at day's dawn. Burnt toast broken up on the simple white plate. Your morning alone. Now that was spelled M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G. Yes, in morning.
Very good.
Okay, this is for those people who think that haiku is just over the great doom, under a harvest moon, your silhouette naked.
Wow. All right, thank you so much. Mr. Martin Joseph, you know you're following me.
Well then, Martin.
Did I say that well enough?
I thought you said Michael Hart. Right.
Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. And this thing, if you have a cell phone, turn it off like that. This helps a lot. I'm an innocent.
Yeah, you were.
Don't do this at home. I mean, he's a professional. Are you ready? I'm ready. And after him, we have our feature, just so you know what I know.
Good evening, Sacred Grounds.
Good evening, Mr. Molly. Joseph.
Hi, Molly. Yeah. She knows it's being recorded for my granddaughter.
Hey, when is she coming back?
August.
We want Molly.
Yeah.
All right. You hear that?
Hey, Molly. Yeah.
We're not talking about the drug. It's the second double on top of that.
Okay, good evening, Sacred Graph.
Good evening.
One of the potential perks of being a parent is that your child may someday turn you into a grandparent. And it may result in a poem like this. This one is called Mama, Mama, Mama. Mama, 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 look what I can do. When years are too big for measurement and there's only one anyway, you have to measure everything in months. Bouncing on the trampoline, bouncing on the mattress, up and up, then over and flop, only to get up and start it once again. So glad to be here that she squeaks in joy. Mama, 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 you give me the world and I will give it back to you. With new eyes and wonderment, with new tears at the littlest things, because down here, they are not so little, not so little at all. Someday, you'll be wrinkled. Someday, you will see this child grown up to spectacular heights, with another generation of bouncing ones, and you will think to yourself, I created that.
Wonderful.
That's all we can come back to.
And this is an extremely short one, so pay attention. This one is called Shirt Haiku. I will change my shirt to something without soy sauce on it, just as a fashion statement.
Thank you so much. And now for the baritone solo leading into the main event here. I always like ragging on people at this point because they don't think I'm going to go on for a long time. Let me consult my notes. Only kidding. Clara Sue, a well-known poet in the Bay Area in San Francisco, a favorite here and in many other places. Good of heart, kind of soul, and even though she's quiet, that doesn't mean her poems are. Power, caring, gentility, and that's somewhat fair. Miss Clarence Sue, would you kindly come to the podium?
All right. To my right.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you.
In October, I went to Warsaw, Poland, because I was very lucky. I bought a ticket. I bought one ticket, but actually it was three tickets for three nights of the final competition of the Chopin International Piano Competition. So I had the last three nights, which turned out to be piano concertos. And Chopin only wrote two piano concertos, and there were 10 candidates, and nine of them play the same one. So as an audience, and we worked very hard with the orchestra and the conductor, because the Kennedy just come out and play one that we had to listen to a lot for them. So anyway, I have some poems about my journey to Warsaw, and I'll start with this one. It's titled Home. After from more than 12 hours of flight, it's a very funny feeling to get off to Warsaw Central and feel that I haven't left home at all. Home. Home is the big downtown, hurried rhythm, cold shoulder shrugs. Home is the big signs, flashing neons, malls, and hotels. To go away is to arrive at familiarity, the comfort of international chains, global logos. Indoor heating systems provide the warmth. Glass revolving doors recycle tourists. Warsaw Central, the heart, is the place of exchange. Mechanical valves opening, closing. Home is where businesses get done. Home is traffic jam. Home is everyone talking in a foreign language. Home is, give me a map, please. It was a little disappointing, but immediately when I found out where we were staying, we stayed in a very nice place close to the old town. Warsaw was completely destroyed during the Second World War, and it was so devastated during that time that they had wanted to, after the war, they had wanted to move the capital to another place. But the people in Warsaw decided that they wanted to stay and rebuild the city. And they did, and they rebuilt it using whatever architectural drawings historical paintings that they had. And they rebuilt the city, and they're still actively doing that. And so you see all these historical buildings, but they're new. It's amazing. Mm. Anyway, so before I left, I decided to learn some Polish. And I found a very good website called Memrise on the internet. And so this is my Polish lesson. If dog is PS, then he is on. And Anna is she, and Pian is five. I have Yamam, the train, Pochang, Pochang, Pochang. Shes, they say, hi and bye. Shesk, you mean the number six? Oh, Osham, but that's because you are eight. Have a good day, Jin Dobry. Tak, tak, yes. Thank you. I teach piano part-time. And when I told one of my piano teacher friends that I'm going to Warsaw, she got all excited and she wanted to come too. So she came, and then another teacher who had been to the Chopin competition about 5 years ago said, you have to go to Chopin's birthplace because it is gorgeous. So we had to go, and we took the train. It's about an hour away from Warsaw. It's a place called Sala Zowa Wola. And indeed, it was a very beautiful place, but in my mind, something was not quite right. And they really dressed up the place. It was a nothing place. It was just a tiny, tiny village. But they made it into this huge, romantic place. So when after I came back, I had I met a friend who actually was half Polish, and he stayed in Sala Zowa Wola when he was a child, and he said that beautiful river that I saw with a half moon bridge on it was nothing but a sewage when he was growing up.
Wow.
Anyway, so this is titled The Rebirth of Sala Zowa Wola. Romance, laced with purpose, handles nature with white gloves, so that each utterance, whether a splatter of rain, a fiery bush among golden willows, or fallen leaves masking an autumn stream, is as delicate as the man, his curled hair, his distinctive nose, his melancholic eyes, is as sensitive as his fingers caressing the keyboard as if it was a woman's breast. The house that was burned down ages ago. It sheltered him as an infant and bore the rawness of his cries. The house that is, a black and white elegant period structure thoughtfully staged behind a reflective pond. The immense garden, sloping hills, and his statues, now pensive with his hand on his heart, now with a wing-like cape, all bear semblance to the unattainable. Piano music flows in the air in a minor key. Serenity in this manifestation seduces the pilgrims, stargazers of the imagination. They sleepwalk from one dream sequence to the next. But for the lover who left his homeland, beauty was the clump of soil he held in his hand. Chopin was born in Sala Zowa Wola, and then he lived in Warsaw for many years, growing up in Warsaw, and then he left Warsaw in his 20s and traveled in Europe to raise funds for the resistance for the war. And at one point he asked his sister to send him a clump of soil so that he can remember his home. So the next three or four pieces were written after I listened to the piano performances. So anyway, I'll start. This one is after Alosha
Juranich's performance of A2 Opus 25, number 11, Winter Storm. The pianist seizes time with his fingers. Thunder, lightning, a deluge of gibberish on roller coaster, pounding waves on pounding hearts, bounded in their seats with all the doors closed. The audience is trapped in the elegant hall. Merciless hammers, screaming strings, rapid bullets shoot out from the hollow of the great black box. The ghosts of men rise up, bearing the assault with their chest. Power, anger, rage ring in their ears, boiling the blood. Mad dogs bark because mad dog recognizes the bark when they hear one. And soon the hall is filled with the most primitive agreement, kill or be killed. If Chopin was not consumptive, he too would have wrung the cravens by the neck and walked off the stage with a flip of his hair. This is after Dmitry Shishkin, who's a Russian performer, a performance of Chopin's E minor concerto. While I was there, I was walking on the street one time, and I was passing the university, and they had a demonstration, and they were burning a pot of fire, and then next to it there was a stereo, and they were playing Chopin's music during the demonstration. So I thought that was pretty neat. Within the interlacing element, strong are the columns. Your love, my death, rise from the bowels of sound. Chopin in protest, upholding angels, playing his dead march, letting the ethereal light at a university's worker demonstration, revealing heaven, a pot of fire next to the amplifiers, in all its wonderment, burning contracts that were signed in blood and the smearing cold rain of Warsaw. I think that I'm going off to die, Chopin predicted before leaving Poland. And how awful it must be to die somewhere else than where one has lived. Remnants of Syrian migrants passing through, the train station has been swept clean. Police walk through each compartment looking for a certain color, a gloomy harmony with a legato smooth as the erasure of history. The winner for the competition was a South Korean. His name is Song Jin-cho. After Song Jin-cho's performance of Chopin's 24 Preludes, the imperfection comes not from the perfection of the playing. For perfect playing does not invoke conflicts in emotions, nor bring about pain and sufferings. Sensing perfection, one willingly gives up the rein, passing control to the higher authority, letting the guide reveal one mystery after another, and at the end applaud the marvelous journey, the pleasant surprises, while safely touched down on earth again. The imperfection, therefore, comes from a judgment, a prejudice against the representative of a country. The downward points of his upper lips, the single syllabic sound of his name, are reminders of the rape in a summer night, in the innocence of my youth, in the safety of a college dorm. It is through this imperfection that I write about a perfect performance, when memory has served its purpose of reminding. But in the flow of music, it is nothing more. Wow. So, with 10 candidates, two of them were women, and they were both Asian. One was a Japanese woman, and the other one was a Chinese woman, but she is American, so we actually, and she won the bronze medal for it, so, yeah. So we did well. So anyway, the women, of course, came out with beautiful gowns, and they're very, it really added a lot to the spectacle. I can't help it, I wrote this. After Amy Kobayashi and Kate Liu's performances on Chopin's E minor concerto, Cinderella, in a blue shimmering gown, got slapped on the behind by her fairy godmother. She waltzed into the hall to thunderous applause, began her dance on the ivory keyboard. She couldn't believe this wondrous night, a pumpkin coach being pulled by mice, agony entwined with ecstasy, her face writhed with every crescendo. Oh, what a plaything this concerto. How lovely, how sweet, how cute, how naughty. It tingled her spine. It made her cry. It made her smile. It made her sigh. When midnight came a thundering, she rose from her seat triumphant. A loving hug from the mighty prince, she retreated to the wing to wait for her fate. Athena came, pure white and Grecian, slim in her young form, not quite a woman. Yet within her stealth, a cool fire intensified as the music swelled. She let the vibrations charge her body, mouth half opened, toward ether she stared. When it was time, she raised her arms, "Hear ye, hear ye," thus spoke Athena. "Romance is tenderness with intelligence. One must not do without the other. Tread lightly on the field of sound, lest harm is done to the hidden jewels." She put on her helmet and held her spear, charged straight to the end with Nike in her hands. As she surveyed the horde of admirers, her demeanor melted into a brilliant smile. While men in tuxes are elegant and bold, women in gowns add extra spices. All had been given, all had been told. Fate in solemnity rolled the dice. On October 17 was Chopin's death date, and every 5 years to coincide with the competition, they would perform Mozart's Requiem in the Sacred Heart, the Church of the Sacred Cross, where Chopin's heart was interred. And when after Chopin died, he wanted his heart to go back to Warsaw, and so his sister smuggled the heart back. During this, earlier this year, I saw on the internet I think on YouTube, but also in the news, that this pianist in Yarmouk in Syria rode his piano out in the street and he started playing there, and so and all his friends came and sang with him. The ISIS actually destroyed his piano and he had to leave Syria, and I think he was, I don't know if he had made it to Germany yet, but he was heading that way.
last time I read the news. So when I was in, when I was listening to the Mozart's Requiem, I was thinking of him. Bearer of the Sacred Cross. Emigration as a community was in a way born of defect and not in order to forget. Kamila Pinyagnoska. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. Christe eleison, a people move. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. In the multitude, some are workers, some are scholars, some are artists. One plays the piano. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. Christe eleison, a people move. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. He played in the streets on his out-of-tune piano. Amid guns and grenades, he sang his songs. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. Christe eleison, a people move. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. People gathered around and raised their voices. Although everything was destroyed, their lives might be untimely shortened, but their song would always remain. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. Christe eleison, a people move. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. They burned his piano. They silenced his band. The pianist of Yarmouk began his journey. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. Christe eleison, a people move. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. From Syria to Turkey, from Greece to Macedonia, he dreams of playing the piano in the streets of Berlin. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. Christe eleison, a people move. Kyrie eleison, in desperation. In a dark night, Ludwika Chopin smuggled her brother's heart, preserved in a jar filled with cognac, back to Poland and placed it at the Sacred Cross. Where your treasure is, there will be your heart also.
Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Just an interjection. Didn't I tell you?
I'd like to end with one poem, short poem. This is for Lewis. So sick, Nim No Gil. Dai Gong Dong Hui Long Tong Chun, Chin Gu Fong Lao Yang Ma. Gulu Sai Bin Yan Do Si, Sam Gok Zhou Long Chek Pig. 亂石崩雲,驚濤裂岸,捲起千堆雪。江山如畫,一時多少豪傑。遙想共情當年,小橋初嫁了,雄姿英髮,羽扇鱗根,談笑間強怒灰飛煙滅。故國神游,多情應笑我,早生華髮,人生如夢。
Thank you so much. We have a really good kicker of a second half here. I know there's a couple of people out there that have read here but haven't signed in, so this. The first half got filled, but there's spaces in the second half easily, so if you wanted to read, just come up and sign in. We're going to take a little bit of a break, 8 minutes, 10 minutes-ish. Talk, schmooze, and I'll be putting this down so you know you can don't have to worry about being dropped and called. Be back in about 8 minutes. What?
Are the food and drinks good here, Dan?
Yes, they are. Food and drinks are fine. See the man in the back. He has everything you might want. If not that, he gets so close. You'll be comfortable.
Thank you, Mark.